Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cohen, and I'm the Executive Director of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York. Our mission is to use the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. We're excited to welcome today Dr. Laura Roberto, who will talk about Italian internment during World War II and the limits of racism in America. Today's event is part of the KHC's 2020 National Endowment for the Humanities Colloquium entitled Internment and Resistance, Confronting Mass Detention and Dehumanization. And it's presented in partnership with the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute at Queens College at the City University of New York and the Nancy and David Wolfe Holocaust and Humanities Center in Cincinnati. It's also connected to the Kupferberg Holocaust Center's virtual exhibition, The Concentration Camps, Inside the Nazi System of Incarceration and Genocide. After the presentation, we'll have some time to answer questions, so please use the Q&A feature on your screen. Now I'd like to introduce Dr. Mark Van Els, Professor of History at Queensborough Community College, who will be moderating today's conversation. Dr. Van Els received his BA, his MA, and his doctoral degree from the University of Wisconsin in Madison and is a native of the Badger State. Prior to his position at Queensborough, he taught at Mount Scenario College and the University of Wisconsin in Plateville. Dr. Van Els also served as archivist and historian at the Wisconsin Veterans Museum in Madison. His research specialties include the cultural history of the U.S. military, World War II, immigration and ethnicity, and popular culture. Dr. Van Els is currently writing a history of the 32nd Infantry Division during World War II, and now I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Van Els.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that, but I'm not the main center of event, not the main person here, of course. I'm very honored, and it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Laura Roberto. She is humanities professor at Berkeley City College in California. Her research focuses on Italian and Italian-American film, material culture, and cultural theories of migration. Her most recent books are the two-volume co-edited collection, New Italian Migrations to the United States. A former Fulbright faculty scholar to Italy, her work has also been supported by the National Endowment for the Humanities. She is an editor of the Fordham University Press series, Critical Studies in Italian America, and was named a 2020-2021 Community College Faculty Fellow for the Mellon Foundation and the American Council of Learned Societies. And without further ado, Dr. Roberto, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. And I want to start today by just thanking all of the sponsoring organizations for this event and inviting me here. It's really exciting to see the Queensborough Community College Holocaust Center having these broad conversations around war and internment and our continual kind of importance of discussing these themes as we move into the 21st century and beyond, I should say. And I'm really particularly grateful to Professors Cohen and Van Ellis and Amy Traver for the conversation specifically today and for all of the people who are listening to us this morning and afternoon. My talk today covers some of the overlapping realities for Italians in the United States during World War II, and I'm specifically interested in multiple ways of understanding the concepts of internment and incarceration. And it's a topic I've been researching as part of my Mellon ACLS Community College Faculty Fellowship grant. And I'm excited to share this information with you all today. And my focus today is on various kinds of internment of Italians in the United States, with a specific interest of mine in those identified as prisoners of war and seeing them in relation to other kinds of restricted and detained groups. So with that, I'm gonna try to share my screen and get started here. The first thing I want to do is in fact show you a very short clip of a US military training film. And you'll see an American military personnel who's interviewing an Italian soldier. This training film was, and it's an instructional film for American soldiers who are being trained to interrogate American enemies, prisoners of war, at the time German, Japanese, and Italians. And it was made in 1943. The subtitles are a little strange, but I believe you'll be able to understand them.
Siete stato mai in America? No, mai. Gran paese d'America. Vi piacerebbe, specialmente Providence, Rhode Island. Avete letto la mia lettera? Non vi posso nascondere nulla. Sì, ho letto la vostra lettera. Deve essere un bravo uomo vostro zio.
Oh sì, proprio un bravo uomo.
Peccato che lo debba denunziare all'FBI.
FBI? Che cos'è?
La polizia segreta americana.
Oh, come la Gestapo tedesca?
No, non esattamente, però...
Perché dovreste far ciò?
Vostro zio ed altri come lui vivono in America e mandano denaro qui. Aiutano il nostro nemico. Se siamo stati indulgenti finora, oggi non lo saremo più.
No, il denaro lo mandava mia madre e sua sorella, ma non più.
Lo mandava ad essa e adesso lo dava al partito fascista.
No, no, non l'ha mai dato, mai, credetemi.
E chi lo sa?
Se lo denunziate lo arresteranno. Mia madre non riceverà più denaro e...
Ne manda tuttora, eh?
No, no, da mesi non ne manda. Vi scongiuro, non l'ho denunziata la vostra Gestapo.
So, my interest in sharing this film clip has to do mainly with the transnational relationship between the Italian prisoner and his Italian-American family in Rhode Island. The obvious way the suspicions around one was used against the suspicions around the other. It points to ties between the two countries on a familial and intimate level, even as the two countries were at war. And it reminds us of some of the contradictions between political and cultural borders that big events like war often bring to the surface. Leading up to and during the Second World War, the United States targeted multiple groups deemed a threat to US security, at one time or another, arresting, detaining, and/or restricting on US soil the actions and livelihood of various groups of people associated with Germany, Italy, and Japan. These included members of the military, soldiers fighting for what was at the time enemy nations, taken prisoner in combat zones and brought to the US. And these POWs I'll return to in a moment. The US also targeted hundreds of thousands of German, Italian, or Japanese civilians, not always in the same way, for potential or actual arrest, detainment, incarceration, and other ways of restrictive lives. These civilians we can further categorize. They include foreigners. They include foreigners found on US soil or waters during the war, such as Italian and German cruise ship workers, including over 500 German men who spent over 6 years between Ellis Island, Angel Island here in San Francisco, and an internment camp in New Mexico. But they also importantly include foreign-born legal US residents, the group commonly referred to as enemy aliens. This group included those legally living in the United States who were not American citizens, but also, as we know, many cases of naturalized citizens or those who were born in the US, including children. The restrictions, and in some cases internment, or better called incarceration, of these communities varies wildly, with Germans and Italians receiving the most lenient actions and Japanese the most restricted. The way these three ethnic groups were treated points to the way institutional racism, bigotry, xenophobia, and cultural prejudice has functioned in the United States. At the same time, the relative leniency shown to most German and Italian enemy aliens also reminds us that racial lines can be drawn indiscriminately at any time. The absolutely horrific realities pressed upon Japanese Americans in the 1940s, not to mention earlier, from immigrants being prohibited from becoming American citizens to the forced evacuations of over 120,000 people without due cause, exemplifies how deeply the US's settler colonial system can support racist practices. But the Italian case, with its more willy-nilly characteristics, points to the fine line between belonging and not belonging within such a system. I find the Italian case particularly useful for illustrating the construction of racial structures and the flimsiness or fragility of those structures. Italian Americans by the Second World War had been marginally but visibly accepted into dominant US society as white Americans, but only after decades of a more ambiguous racial shifting status, one that, for instance, influenced the very restrictive 1924 Johnson-Reed Immigration Act. I'm not going to get into too much of it, not going to get into it too much for now, but I call attention to public figures from the 1940s, such as Frank Sinatra or Joe DiMaggio, who point to the acceptance of Italian Americans. At the same time, as there were still long-held xenophobic and anti-immigrant sentiments against Italians in the United States, with many targeted as suspected anti-Americans, be they possibly communists, fascists, or otherwise subversives to an American way of life. This balancing act of Italian Americans standing on the one hand more and more connected to dominant white culture, and on the other ethically and morally suspect and unwanted in the US, is important to keep in mind. But I'm actually not saying anything new. Many scholars have and continue to make sense of this confusion Italian Americans have to their relationship to whiteness. But I wish to add to that confusion by recognizing other Italian identified groups detained on American soil during the war years and see them in relation to one another. I see the case of Italian POWs as one where men experienced a kind of liminal migrant space, so that their time in a POW camp became a kind of restricted, temporary migratory experience, where they shaped their everyday spaces in ethnic-specific ways and redirected their sense of trauma, loss, and concern in creative actions. In a way, both their position as a threat to the US as well as their acceptance was, like that of Italian Americans, a balancing act. In my larger project, I focus on the art and architecture Italian POWs made while in the US. And so I'm going to turn to this topic towards the end of my talk today. A creative outpouring while incarcerated is by no means unique to Italians, nor to wartime or military captivity. The Italian case is not unique, but illustrative of the role of creativity during wartime, the effects incarcerated people have on local landscapes and communities, and the dynamic possibilities of individuals and groups under restrictive lives. Their experiences expand our understanding of the Italian diaspora, Italian migration, and concepts of transnationalism, asking us to consider shape-shifting ways Italian identities on American soil were lived in the 1940s. And this, for me, is part of why it's important to look at this group. The POW case may seem small or somewhat obscure, but it's part of larger experiences of mobility and change that are sparked by war. During World War II, the United States held over 500,000 POWs, most of which ended up incarcerated on American soil. Between 1942 and 1946, the United States held here in the US over 425,000 German POWs, 5,400 Japanese POWs, and over 51,500 Italians. The Italian POWs began arriving to the US in December 1942, and by early fall 1943, they were scattered across at least 28 camps in 22 states. The case specifically of Italian POWs is not a clear case of enemy prisoners of war, given Italy's changing political relationship to the Allies after September 1943, which created new allegiances between the US and Italy against Germany. To muddle further, not all Italian POWs in American hands were actually Italian-born Italians. Some had been born in the United States, were US citizens who had, for various reasons, ended up back in Italy before the war started and drafted into Mussolini's army. At one point, the US military noted at least 40 such American-born Italian POWs. Others still were Slovenians who were conscripted into the Italian army, captured by the British, turned over to the Americans, and brought to the US as Italian POWs. By 1944, an ultimately failed Slovenian-American campaign began to lobby the US federal government to release these Slovenian-Italian POWs from POW camps and allow them to remain in the United States as legal residents. By the time the Italians arrived in the US, they would have already been under Allied custody for at least a month's time. Most had been captured in the African and Sicilian combat zones and then transferred across the globe to India, South Africa, Scotland, and elsewhere. Those who ended up in the US were moved two or three more times throughout their stay on American soil. Their movement, even before arriving to a USPOW camp, is important to recall as it helps illustrate some of the constant uncertainties around place for wartime incarcerated people. And it explains one of the reasons why trying to build a sense of home in camps and connect with Italian American communities might have been important to some of them. Giannino Gherardi, an Italian POW taken prisoner in North Africa, brought first to Wyoming and later to New Jersey, explained imprisonment this way. Without a doubt, the worst condition a man can be reduced to, deprived completely of liberty and thrown around from place to place, always and in every moment like some object. These men did not know when the war would end, nor how Italy's fluctuating political circumstance might affect them. They had limited, heavily censored news about Italy and limited communication with their families. Their livelihood was as precarious as their sense of place, captured already weak, often without consistent sanitation, even after capture. And yet, even with such precariousness, while living behind armed guards and barbed wire, most Italian POWs, in retrospect, described a comfortable life in the United States. Mainstream American newspaper stories from the war era back up this perspective, as you can sort of see here by the sort of smiling faces and rhetoric of this newspaper piece. Meanwhile, Italian American media suggests a slightly different perspective, one of overall concern for the POW's well-being and sense of affiliation with them. To a great degree, the POWs were seen to be another immigrant group needing assistance and to be embraced by those established Italian Americans. Italian American communities tried to improve POWs' general welfare, even while they themselves continued to navigate suspect US national loyalties. Italian language press in the United States regularly published updates about Italian prisoners of war, especially with an interest in connecting them to possible American relatives. Italian POWs had a unique relationship to their captors, given the quasi-mythical position the US had for many. Many had relatives, even parents and siblings in the United States, or who had migrated back and forth from the US, and they thus held real lived knowledge of transnational lives between these two countries. For them, reaching the United States was an event that would have matched those of their families who had arrived previously. Take one POW's description. Quote, our arrival in the port of New York, a place that in our eyes was more like the center of the universe, is an indelible memory, end quote. Such descriptions of an idealized America helps clarify the symbolic position of the US. At the same time, such words also kind of remind us and show us the stark differences in realities between the men's lives in battle versus in captivity. Everyday differences that became even more pronounced for many POWs within less than a year of arriving in the US due to the effects of the 1943 armistice. In September 1943, General Pietro Badoglio of Italy signed an armistice with the Allied forces. This agreement included a stipulation for American and British POWs held by Italy. They had to be released immediately, but the agreement didn't clarify what happened to Italian POWs. In fact, the US ultimately implemented a plan which was never formally agreed upon by Italy and which was not covered by the Geneva's Convention guidelines on POW treatment. And this is a good time to remind you that the Geneva Convention also did not really consider what groups in the US who were called enemy aliens, how that those people should be treated, and nor did the Geneva Convention cover how those Germany classified as Italian military internees, that is, Italian soldiers who refused to fight for Germany after the armistice and were incarcerated in camps throughout Nazi Germany. The Geneva Convention didn't cover that group as well as others. So the US, after the armistice in 43, eventually began screening each POW, offering them the opportunity to renounce fascism and volunteer for non-combatant service, although they would remain under restricted custody until the war ended. The first groups of what the US Army referred to as collaborating Italians or non-combatant Italian service units or ISU members was formed in March 1944. This is over 6 months after Italy had surrendered. Ultimately, over 32,000 became collaborators and lived out the rest of the war with this vague prisoner status that included increased liberties and access beyond the camp, although at any time their liberated state could be revoked. Non-collaborating POWs, those who did not sign allegiance to the US or those who were removed from the collaborating status, remained under stricter control with far fewer interactions with civilians and less freedom to move outside the camp. Regardless of their personal reasons for not agreeing to collaborate, and there were various reasons men didn't sign, they remained representatives of a fascist government that for all intents and purposes no longer existed. In that sense, they were nationless. The living conditions of these non-collaborating Italian POWs worsened, especially their food rations were drastically cut after the Allies arrived at Nazi concentration camps and news of those realities circulated more widely in the US. In comparison to the experiences of other detained and incarcerated people in the US during the war, the Italian POW case, both the collaborators and the non-collaborators, gets recalled as mostly a harmonious affair. And yet, Italian POWs suffered from depression, feelings of isolation, and of guilt towards their families and other soldiers' well-being. Some became ill, and at least 170 Italians died while in US camps. Even with Italy's new relationship to the United States, the attitude towards Italian POWs remained mixed throughout the war. The US military received almost constant criticism from the general public that Italian POWs were being coddled. This criticism sometimes led to very tragic realities, such as when 28 African American soldiers were unfairly convicted of lynching an Italian POW, Guglielmo Olivotto, near Tacoma, Washington. And the Olivotto case demonstrates very clearly the way war exacerbated the already existing racial and class inequities in America. From the moment Italian POWs ended up in American hands, even before they arrived in the US, they were often met with Italian American GIs, many who acted as translators. These interactions with Italian Americans increased in the US, where Italian American GIs continue to be part of their daily lives. Italian POWs upon arriving to the United States were met with what was at the time the largest foreign-born American population. Over 1.6 million Italian-born, over 700,000 who were still Italian citizens, and over 4 million Italian-Americans. Italian-Americans frequently visited the POW camps, often with the hope of connecting with family or friends. ISU men, those collaborating POWs, were permitted to attend outside dinners and other outings hosted by Italian American families, social clubs, and church parishes. There are dozens and dozens of kinship stories from these connections that highlight some of the contradictions of war. There are family reunification stories, romances, the birth of children, post-war courtships and marriages. The millions of Italian Americans had their own complicated relationship to the war. On the one hand, over 850,000 Italian Americans served in the US armed forces, with an unknown number fighting specifically in Italy. But yet, when Italian prisoners had first arrived on American soil in late 1942, restrictions for that over 700,000 Italian resident aliens had only just been lifted symbolically on Columbus Day, October 12, 1942. By early 1940, German, Italian, and Japanese citizens legally residing in the U.S. had to register at local post offices under their new official designation of enemy aliens. As Lawrence DeSassi, Mary Chopa, Stephen Fox, and other scholars have shown, later different restrictions and in some cases incarcerations for each group came with that designation. For the Italians, especially on the West Coast, travel restrictions and a curfew was instituted. Firearms, shortwave radios, cameras, and flashlights were confiscated. Prohibited zones were demarcated, especially along the West Coast, and about 10,000 Italian families up and down the Pacific coast, especially those who worked in the fishing industry, had to move. Fewer than 4,000 were at one point arrested, and fewer than 400 were incarcerated. No mass internment occurred for Italians, or for that matter, for Germans. The regulated constraints and selective internment against Italian Americans, as serious and life-changing as they were, pales in comparison to what happened to Japanese American men, women, and children in the US, even as they reflect these inconsistent racial and cultural biases. Overlapping at the same era was the imprisonment, starting in fact before the US entered the war, mostly in Missoula, Montana, of about 1,500 non-US resident, non-military Italian citizens who were found on American soil when in 1939 and 1940. These included merchant marines, cruise ship workers, and Italians who were working at the World's Fair in New York. This very forgotten group is often conflated with others, with the circa 18,000 assumed fascist non-collaborating POWs, as well as the less than 400 Italian so-called enemy aliens who were also interned. In my larger project, I'm interested in the directed creative actions of Italian POWs in the United States, examples that I want to turn to now as a gesture towards a conclusion. For many, these creative actions reinforced cultural heritage, mediated personal and community identities, shaped evolving notions of self, and ultimately helped make sense of some of the trauma of their displacement and atrocities of war. Through their creativity, they established a sense of place, however fleeting and temporary, while also documenting their wartime experiences. And the objects that men created vary wildly. I just want to show you a small kind of example of some of them. They include items like cigarette cases that were sold or bartered to American GIs, often offering exoticized images of battle locations and places of that captivity before coming to the US. They also include a whole host of objects that evoke family memories, thoughts of home, landscapes, people, as well as a third group of objects that are site-specific pieces that are reflective of their temporary homes here in America, like these murals in Wyoming. I'm particularly taken by the Catholic sacred structures that POWs built or adorned by while they were here in the US, chapels, shrines, and altars, because they illustrate the camps as sites of refuge, of reprieve, of solace, as sites of prayer. By sacralizing the space, they created a sense of community that reached beyond the mundane, beyond the war, beyond the earthly. These include a few sites that are still in existence, such as a small chapel in Hereford, Texas, that was built by non-collaborating POWs, a larger chapel in Chambersburg, Pennsylvania, built by collaborating ISU men, and a small chapel called Chapel in the Meadow that still stands at Camp Atterbury in Indiana. Many others are gone, including a chapel at Camp Monticello, Arkansas, the Madonna del Prigioniero, that was built in that 6-month period before POWs were offered the opportunity to collaborate with the United States. Also now demolished is a chapel that was built by non-collaborating POWs in Hawaii to Mother Cabrini. And this chapel was dedicated in 1946 with a dedication that coincided with the canonization of Cabrini in Rome. Outdoor altars and shrines, mostly built out of stone and salvaged materials, can be found across the US in camp after camp, including many that are now gone, such as one that used to exist at Camp Raritan in New Jersey, as well as another that still exists in Taunton, Massachusetts at the former Camp Miles Standish. These and other such POW-made objects and structures have become, in a sense, decontextualized objects, fragments of a cultural landscape and a singular moment and place, as well as the people whose lives touched it. They materially affected American cultural landscape and the Americans they came into contact with in evolving and lasting ways, even as the POWs themselves had to be repatriated after the war. These various trajectories of Italian identities on American soil all inform and reflect one another in immeasurable ways, from enemy alien to prisoner, from immigrant to war hero. Neither story stands alone, and each pushes a reevaluation of the development of an Italian-American ethnic identity and the role of wartime in the formation of a cultural ethos. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was a very, very interesting talk. I just have a few questions, maybe just sort of expand upon some of the things you mentioned. And what 30 minutes, of course, isn't nearly enough time to talk about such a large topic. Could you expand upon the ideological makeup or disposition of Italian soldiers? Because I think about German prisoners of war, and you had your draftees, and then you had your hardcore Nazis. I'd imagine Italian POWs must have had different attachments to fascism or communism or what have you, if you just comment on the larger picture.
Of course. Yeah, and you're right. It's not unlike the situation in Germany. So you have a large number who were drafted soldiers who didn't necessarily have an ideological position they were particularly connected to. Certainly by 1940 or even the late 1930s, you have a generation who have soldiers who have almost grown up with fascism. So on the other hand, it's part of their everyday life. And at the same time, you have committed fascists who were people who were members of the fascist party and were very much committed to that perspective. The interesting thing about what happens after the armistice is that there was this 6-month period where the POWs in the US were sort of in limbo because no one really knew what was going to happen to them. And then at a certain point, so if the armistice happens in September, and by about February, the US starts implementing this plan to interview them and determine who really is a quote fascist and who isn't, and divide them based on their allegiance. But the interesting thing that happens is for that roughly 18,000 who don't sign allegiance to the US, we can't say that they were just all committed fascists.
There were many. That's kind of what I was wondering.
Yeah.
Like, who cooperated and who didn't?
Right. There are many reasons why men didn't sign. Certainly some didn't sign because they did feel this connection to the fascist ideology, but many felt that it was ethically wrong to switch sides, ethically suspect for them to go against what they had, the allegiance that they had sworn to, regardless of what the beliefs of that allegiance were.
Right.
Others also didn't trust the US at that time. If we think back to like that interrogation video that I showed you, there's good reasons why the Italian soldiers, of course, shouldn't have trusted the Americans. They had such limited news from Italy, so they weren't necessary, of the war in general, so they couldn't really be sure what was going on and if what they were being told really was the truth, right? So some of them didn't sign because they didn't trust the system, basically. Others also didn't sign for maybe more abstract reasons where they felt like they were that really had nothing to do with ideology, but that they were taken as a prisoner. They did not want to work. They refused to work when they were given opportunities to work for limited pay. And they simply felt that their role, they wanted to kind of symbolically embrace their role as prisoners of war, mm-hmm. regardless of the shifting ideologies. So it was messy.
Yeah. And this is beyond the scope of your talk, but I'm just sort of curious if you could put that into a larger perspective of the overall Italian-American community in the 1930s and 1940s. There was a small fascist movement among Italian-Americans, as you had the German-American Bund with the Germans. A lot of Italian-Americans who were, you know, American first. So you just, to put the paper into more context, maybe expand yeah. upon the overall Italian-American right. view of the war.
Right. And that's sort of what was happening, what I've been finding in the actually like the U.S. military's papers is the way that they were reviewing the Italian language press of the time and reviewing Italian-American social organizations' relationship to the POW camp. So the yeah. U.S. really unhappy at first when the Italian-American organizations were trying to access the POWs because they didn't trust them and they found case after case of either Italian-American organizations who were pro-fascist, who wanted to connect with POWs who were potentially fascist, and B, Italian-American organizations who were pro-communist, who were trying to sort of subvert the American kind of vision as well in the camp. So that sort of suspicion, that veiled suspicion of Italian Americans as somehow subverting an American way of life, never really went away, even after the legal status of their position as enemy aliens was lifted. And that lifting of that legal status after 1942 also has so much to do with the US's interest in removing Mussolini and fascism in Italy. They wanted Italian Americans on their side so that they would support through their kind of dialogue and communication with their family in Italy, so that they would be supportive of the Allies entering Italy to remove Mussolini.
Yeah. No, I was interested. I hadn't known about this, that Italian American communities were actually even allowed to have contact with. I can't think of an example of German American societies who there may have been, but I'm not aware of that.
I haven't come across that, and I'm not as familiar with the German case. I know certainly there is a lot of literature out there, and I'm familiar with some of it, but I don't get the sense that the German Americans had the same connection with the German POWs, most likely because their lives were more restricted because it didn't have this shift that didn't happen. Right.
Yeah, we fought the Germans until the very end. Italy wasn't a very different situation.
Similarly with the Japanese, I mean, there were only about 5,000 Japanese POWs, but they never had any access. Of course, most Japanese Americans did not have freedom to move around anyway, but they certainly were not aware of or connected to the POWs here.
And I was thinking about the different regional distinctions in Italy itself, which of course, you know, can be very broad. And if your region of origin in Italy may have had something to do with the way you viewed the United States. I was thinking, for example, how most immigrants to the United States came from south of Rome, and so did Neapolitans or Sicilians view their American sojourn any differently than Venetians or Florentines?
That's a great question. I don't know. I do know that, yes, certainly you're right that by that time, most of the immigrants in the U.S. the majority were coming from the southern regions of Italy. We see examples from what I've gathered, as far as the Italians who POWs who collaborated, they came from all parts of Italy and all classes. what's interesting, of course, is the way that the military life generally attempted to remove those regional differences. You know, I think that's something that's still kind of to be thought about.
And that might be lost because that generation's, that sort of thing's passed on orally, unless you interview someone we might never know that, but it was just a thought I had. Yeah. I was just sort of curious, those who collaborated, what sort of work did they do? Because I know German prisoners of war, they were sent to farms to go pick peas or whatever the case may be. Those collaborating, I forgot the term that you used.
I use Italian service unit.
Yeah. They had somewhat more freedom than a regular POW, but I'm wondering what sorts of things
very they similar
did.
To what you're saying. They picked cotton in the South. They picked peaches in Georgia. They worked in some factories. They had a little bit more access, I guess, outside of the camps in the rural areas they did some factory work. They were not supposed to be involved in like directly military work. However, I know of at least one case where the POW camp was on an arsenal, a former arsenal. So they were actually doing kind of ancillary military related labor.
No, another thought I had was you oftentimes found ethnic groups within the United States, men mostly, who were in the military and served as translators and things like that. And these cooperating Italian former prisoners of war would not have been tasked with that kind of work. But I imagine there must have been Italian Americans who were part of their military duties were military government or translation or something like that.
And so in fact, yes, both when they were captured in Sicily or North Africa, you can find listed that their Italian American GIs were acting as formal translators well as like informal, as well as the camps, of course, all because of the rules of the Geneva Convention, they all had religious leaders. They all had the Italians had Catholic priests that were assigned to the camps, and most of those I've found so far were Italian American. And the little documentation that exists suggests that they were speaking Italian, that they could actually kind of communicate and create a kind of sense of a community through that as well.
I've just got two things, and I'll open it up to the other thing. This is more of a comment than a question, I guess, but I was really fascinated by the artworks that the prisoners created. Now, you find this in military history a lot. I've done a little bit of work on this. American GIs, if you're stuck in the jungles of New Guinea somewhere, they'll carve something for their girlfriend with a piece of tropical wood or something like this. I was just kind of curious, where did you find these materials?
Oh yeah. So, and that's really there. You're right. You know, they appear, it's not just an Italian thing, of course. They're a little bit, you have to look for them. There's not a single archive that has them all present. A lot of online auctions, small localized archives, so that the historical centers associated with the former camps tend to all have small kind of public libraries and other kind of localized archives that sometimes house these things or references to them. So a lot of times I have found references to such things in oral histories or in newspaper articles, but not a photo or not the actual object, but I have kind of accrued a small collection, either directly or indirectly.
I used to work in the museum world, and as a work study student, used to catalog the artifacts, and things like this would come in, and there was always interesting to me. Mm-hmm. Anyway, one last thing. I was wondering the experience of Italian POWs in the United States, if this may have had any impact on post-war Italian culture, popular culture in some way, or just the Italian interactions with the United States, how that may or may have affected film, literature. I don't study that, but I'd be very interested in your perspective.
Well, probably the most well-known example that I can give you is the opening scene to The Godfather. Both the novel, Mario Puzo's novel, as well as Coppola's film, one of the men who first come to the Don to ask for a favor is a baker whose daughter has fallen in love. He says he's fallen in love with a POW. And in the novel, actually, there's a description about the man who has an Italy patch on his on his arm, which actually identifies him not as a non-collaborating POW, but in fact as an Italian service unit. Because the only reason why an Italian-American family would have been able to get that close to a POW is if he had become a collaborator. Mm-hmm. So that's like probably the most famous example that often almost like just kind of pass over it without really referencing it or thinking about it as part of this.
Yeah. All right. Very fascinating. Thank you very much. I'll let others have a crack at you.
Sure.
Hi. Thank you so much. There's a really lively Q&A going, and some of the themes have already been touched upon. And I just wanted to build on what you mentioned and what Dr. Van Els mentioned. In terms of your research process, you were talking about the challenges of finding art. But I wonder also in terms of how you've done this research, because it's so layered in terms of different identities. There's questions coming up around, for example, the different treatment of POWs who might have had higher ranks. So could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, and the research here, it's very much ongoing, and certainly just in this last 9 months has been curtailed by the pandemic, which coincided with my grant time. So it's been a kind of a new approach to research. But there is a small collection of oral histories of former POWs. I've been able over the years to do some of that ethnographic work myself as well. And then it's really about kind of localized research. Really, I've had the good fortune to visit a number of these former campsites, and most of these campsites have small collections of their own. And then also it's been important to try to connect the stories back to Italy, because there is a sort of an unknown number of former POWs who, once they were repatriated to Italy, which they had to be by the Geneva Convention, some unknown number immigrated, and we don't really know how many, but most of them most likely stayed in Italy, or at least some of their family did. And so I've been doing some research connecting there as well, and finding those sort of at least secondhand family stories, as well as objects, letters, journals, and the like back in Italy.
I think it's really interesting the way you're talking also about localized research. It's definitely a trend we find in Holocaust studies and education, where, for so many years, it was trying to say what had actually happened from a much bigger and a macro perspective. And so much of the turn now in Holocaust education focuses on micro histories. I'm curious, we had a question from our colleague in Johannesburg. What is the percentage of Italian POWs that stayed and settled in the US? Mm-hmm. She's aware that many settled also in South Africa.
Right. South Africa also had a big community of POWs. That's true. And again, we don't really know what the percentage is. There was a documentary made about 20 years ago called Prisoners in Paradise by Camilla Calamandre, that actually she kind of went and tried to document some of the marriages that came about from these interactions with civilians. And there's really, I've seen some numbers that say 8,000 to 10,000, but at the time it was pretty much near impossible to stay in the US and not go back. You had to put, I believe you had to prove that you had fathered a child, and even that was not straightforward in order to not have to be repatriated first. So most, even the marriages that came about from those connections, the American women had to travel to Italy to marry the former POW in order, and then come back to the US.
And, you know, on the question of mobility, Dr. Traver, we'd like to know, you know, your research focuses, and I'm looking at my phone, it's written down, your research focuses on mobility, but also on material culture, which seem to derive from and be reflective of space and place, which you've talked a lot about. Can you speak more generally to this productive but paradoxical intersection?
Yeah, I really think that material culture is just a, first of all, it's a really useful way to visualize how mobility functions and how it continues to have a life sometimes beyond the actual immigrant or mobile culture, whatever, or mobile wave. And it kind of gives us multiple layers for trying to understand people and communities' actions, their emotions and the motivations they have, and the way in which they're kind of trying to connect their, in the case of this art and architecture that they that I've been studying, it's a really helpful way for us to think about the way individuals were thinking beyond the space that they were in and communicating with others through what they were creating and using their experiences from before the war, during the war, and thinking beyond that in some way. And I think it does, and to sort of return to a question that Professor Van Ellis asked me earlier, like it, as far as how the POW existence continues to resonate after the war is sometimes in these objects. So that I've come across again and again, American families, Italian American or not, who have paintings or drawings or sculptures that and jewelry even that were gifted to them by POWs that they've held onto over generations now. And that becomes, again, those are those like small histories that are telling larger stories about the role war has in connecting people, even through this tragic and divisive experiences.
It's interesting that you're talking about generational memories and the use of objects as a way to kind of communicate that sort of collective experience. One of our, John Yee, who is a professor at Queensborough Community College, he's leading this year's Common Read, which is on George Takei's book on the Japanese internment camps. One of the themes that we're talking about a lot this semester is connecting all of this. And so his question is, could you speak about the broader implications and or connections about your work on Italian POWs and Italian Americans and what the connections are with contemporary issues around race, ethnicity, national identity, or human rights?
Okay, yeah. I really feel like what I was trying to do in putting these different groups in communication with one another is to reinforce this idea that our, first of all, historically, our understanding of race in America is not clean cut. It's not easy to follow it. And it's not always been the same. And that it's this evolving process. And that when we think about the historical case specifically of Italians, we have these multiple groups that are identified as Italian at the same time on US soil who don't have similar experiences. And to me, I find that a really kind of nonsensical. If we compare it to the Japanese case is so brutally, clearly this example of how racism functions in America and how xenophobia functions in America. And even there with its own contradictions, right? Because you have Japanese American soldiers who are fighting in a war while their parents are incarcerated. So you have some of that contradiction in the Japanese case as well. The Italian case just really, I feel like, blows it up even further because you have Joe DiMaggio, who's a hero and a popular figure, but his father's not allowed to go fishing. And his boats, he has restricted use of his fishing boat in San Francisco at the same time. You know, you have Ezio Pinza, this leading opera singer who enrolls as he's supposed to as an enemy alien, but is still a suspected fascist. And so he's put in jail in New York for 11 weeks until he's released. So these confusing moments, I think, speak to our contemporary moment where we have seen, especially, you know, in the last four years or so, how quickly this kind of fear of immigrants, fear of others, surfaces in our country, and that we reinstitute boundaries and divisions between people. Even groups who appear to be kind of dominant or appear to be in control of sort of the status quo. And so I think it's of course useful to remember the past in informing how we talk about the present and see each other in this moment.
It definitely, thank you for talking about that, because I think so much right now of the rhetoric and the way people in the United States are talking about identity is so often it feels very separate, and there is a lot of nuance here. I'm mindful of the time, Dr. Van Els. I wanted to know if you had any other questions, or would you like to contribute more?
I was just going to say, I'm looking forward to this coming out in print. I'm very interested to read the larger project, and I found it very, very interesting.
Thank you. I haven't had a chance to look at the Q&A myself. I don't know if...
There is one question that's popped up. You know, so much of the discussion has been today on the different groups and categories of people, POW versus soldier, Italian-American versus Italian, born here, going back. Another question comes up about acknowledgement. I wanted to just briefly ask you a little bit about your perspective on President Clinton's apology.
Right. I don't know that I have much of an opinion on it. I think I don't want to get into the sort of politics of it, but I think there's relevance in having the government publicly try to make sense of its past actions, and that there's an importance to that. It certainly helps make the historical case more visible. I think I would prefer for the historical case to be more clearly talked about in like K-12 education. Like, to me, that would be like more significant than something like what Clinton did. But that's the educator in me, I think, that sort of prefers to see our conversations about these historical moments brought to, in a more sophisticated way, to our educational practices and our teaching practices.
It's something that's come through a lot today in your presentation, is how do we integrate sort of the scholarly approach versus the educational approach. And as just sort of a last question, you know, for our audience, you know, what's something they should take away from today? You know, if there's one thing you want them to stick with and that resonates, is there something?
Well, I would say that is just this mindfulness about the way in which our current understanding of ethnicity and difference in America is not born from thin air, and in fact is very deeply related to so much of this historical conversation that I think is really lost to us. I was reminded in preparing this talk today, just thinking about how long ago the Second World War was, and especially since I know we have some student base and watching an event like this, and thinking about the fact that, you know, when I was a college student, what that 70-year plus distance would have meant for me, it really feels like this distant past. And so I think it's just really important to try to connect those those past moments to our contemporary moment. I think it's wonderful that Queensborough Community College has this READ program this year, and that the book is so important, and it really allows you and everybody to bring this conversation to a wider audience.
Thank you so much. I mean, I've learned a lot, and it's been quite illuminating. It's been lovely speaking with you today. I want to thank you. I want to thank Dr. Van Els, Dr. Traver. I want to thank our partners today, the Nancy and David Wolf Holocaust and Humanity Center and the Calandra Institute. Yes, today has been recorded as well, and we'll send that out to all of you via Zoom, and it'll be available on our website. Thank you, everyone. We hope you stay safe and be well. Bye.